topic is hospital committees for the quality system. All those of us who are working in the hospitals which are accredited either by the NABH or by the JCI or even the NQAS system, which is for the government hospitals, we all have worked in the committees. We all know that the committees are required. They are essential elements in the hospital functioning, but there is a need to have clarity on how these committees are required to function. And there are some peculiar requirements which are of the accreditation system when it comes to committees. So both the JCI and the NABH, they want the hospitals which are which are implementing the accreditation system and the quality system, they want these committees to be evaluated in some manner. In some manner, the functioning of the committees and whether the committees are effective in their functioning, whether they are able to contribute, and whether somebody is confirming that they are contributing to the hospital functioning. This is an element that needs to be recorded, and it is part of the assessment or the JCI survey when that happens. So committee functioning is something that is that a lot of people find tricky, and we are going to cover that today. So let me start the presentation, and then I'll share that screen with everyone, and everyone can have a look at that. So a little confirmation from as many of you as possible on through the chat box that the presentation is visible to you, and also that this audio and the video is all right. Fantastic. So so we will start with that, and this is the first slide. Which essentially talks about the staff structure. In the hospitals which are functioning and which are preparing for the NABH accreditation or the JCI accreditation or the NQAS accreditation, Colonel Sood sir, welcome. Someone has switched on the presentation. Mr. Srikant Nair, you'll have to close this. Is the screen visible? I am not getting a notification for that, so I need to confirm that. Okay, just a moment. Let me. So two requests which I have to all of us who are joined in the in this Google Meet, please keep your microphone on mute, and also do not click the present now button, because it will interfere with the presentation that is going on. So we are talking about the committees, and in the hospitals we have various kinds of staff structures. And committee is one such staff structure. A staff structure basically means that it is a group of people who are designated to perform a certain function, and committee is one form of staff structures. The other structures are teams, which are largely the task specific. So you may have an infection control team or a facility safety team, or whether a facility maintenance team. You can also have other kinds of staff structures. For example, the task groups. These are essentially temporary in nature. So when you have a group which is assigned a responsibility which is time bound and a one time activity, a lot of hospitals, when they are preparing for implementing a quality system, they assign small groups for various tasks. For example, someone is responsible for writing SOP for infection control or for infection surveillance. Another group may be responsible for designing the procedures for quality system in the lab or in the imaging. So like that. So these are small part-time or one-time groups, which are called the task groups. They finish the task and the group's organization is dissolved. But the teams are usually permanent in nature. So you have an infection control team, you might have a safety team, you might have other quality team. So these teams are permanent in nature and they have ongoing work that they are supposed to perform. So today's presentation, we are looking at the committees specifically, and committees are the staff structures which are required for implementing the quality systems in the hospitals. Why they are required? Because committees allow people in the organization to get together, to collaborate, and to have a system where there is a collaborative decision making. Because a collaborative decision making is something that gives us the value, and it also is able to establish the buy-in. Buy-in, that means people voluntarily and willingly join to contribute and work in these committees and then implement various systems. So, these committees are basically for achieving various objectives. So you may have a quality committee that is meant for achieving the quality, or infection control committee addressing the requirements of infection control. So like that. So these are the examples of committees. And for each of these staff structures, including the committees, we are required to define the processes. Processes in the sense what they will do, how they will do, what will be the terms of their engagement, what will be the manner of their functioning, how often they will meet. So these kind of requirements are to be defined for if we expect or if we want committees and these staff structures to achieve meaningful objectives. The next is also to define the measurements for outcomes. So how do we know that a committee has contributed to the hospital functioning and to the objective with which it was formed? So for example, you may have a committee which is meant for the infection control activities. Now you have defined that they will meet every 3 months or every 6 months. They are meeting also, but how do we know that they are contributing to the infection control and the infection control activities are getting better over a period of time? Whether the infection control activities are actually helping reduce the infection. So some kind of some form of measurement has to be defined, and these measurements are also part of the terms of reference that we have for the committees. So these are the levels or the kind of committees that we have. So typically in a hospital which is implementing an accreditation system or a quality system, they will have a top level committee which is variously called. I mean, the name is not important, the function is important. So you have a committee which is called a steering committee, or it can be called a apex committee or a core committee. So depending on what kind of what name a hospital wants to give, a name can be given. This essentially is the committee where the buck stops. That means everything that is happening in the hospital in relation to the quality system will be eventually addressed by this committee. And this is the committee where you have top functionaries involved. You will have senior people who are responsible for taking resource related decisions. So they will be part of these this committee. People who are responsible for allocating staff, for recruiting staff. So those kind of people will be there, because they are the ones who will be making the resources available for the hospital to function. Then the next level of committees will be the functional committees. These committees look after the domains which are pan-hospital. So you may have a committee which is addressing infection control, which is something which is applicable to the entire hospital. You may have a separate quality committee which addresses the quality-related systems and processes, which is again pan-hospital. you will have a resource allocation committee. This is something which I've seen in many hospitals where there are competing demands. I mean, they eventually every hospital has some limitation on the resources because the finances and other things will have a limitation. So somebody has to prioritize. So when there is a competing demand, this committee addresses which one to take up first and which one to take up subsequently. Similarly, there will be across the hospital, there will be a committee called Ethics Committee, which will look at the ethical compliance requirements of the hospital. And this may be for research, this may be for the treatment activities, this may be for various other requirements, for example, organ transplantation or when you are taking decisions related to the implementation of Supreme Court guidelines on withdrawing life support, etc. So this committee comes into play where they get involved in just about every part of functioning of the hospital. Then you have another cross function or a pan hospital committee called the credentialing and the privileging committee. This committee again is responsible for privileging and ascertaining the credentialing requirement in the hospital. So again, this is a pan hospital committee. Likewise, you can have more committees. Here the intent is not to give a list of the committees, but to give the logic of how to create committees in the hospital. And then you have committees which are the specialist committees. I mean, they function in a very narrow domain in the hospital. And these committees typically address one small function. For example, you have a committee which is for evaluation of the cardiopulmonary resuscitation activities. In a lot of hospitals, it is known as the Code Blue Committee. So I think some people have pointed out that the presentation is not visible. I am sure it is visible now. This presentation can be shared. So if you share your email ID, then I can this presentation can be shared with all of you. It is possible only if the email ID is available. There is no other way to ensure that. So these specialist committees address a very narrow domain. For example, cardiopulmonary resuscitation or the blood transfusion, or a committee which is addressing the requirements of the organ transplant, or a drugs and therapeutics committee which addresses the procurements and storage management of the medications and other consumables, implants, etc. You may have a very specific committee called the infection control committee. Infection control committee, depending on how you look at it, can also be called a functional committee which has a role pan hospital, or you can call it a very specific domain specific committee because it addresses a very specific infection control domain. So these are the committees. Now you also have some statutory committees. The law requires that the hospitals must have a committee to address the certain issues. So you may need to have an internal complaints committee for addressing the requirements of prevention of sexual harassment of women at workplace. You may also have a grievance redressal committee for staff grievance. You may have a radiation safety committee or a committee to address the biomedical waste management related issues. So these are the committees which are statutory committees. The law requires us to have these committees. So these are the variety of committees that we have in the hospitals. Next, we look at the committee design. So what all is required to be kept in mind when we design or when we create a committee? Foremost is to have an objective or the purpose of this committee. So if we have defined what is the purpose for this committee, this must be articulated carefully. It must be stated and it should be recorded. So typically in a hospital, you have a system where office order is given or some form of notification is taken out that such and such committee has been constituted. So when you have this notification must contain the purpose of the committee, because in the absence of purpose, the committees will not be able to function properly, and neither other people will come to know what is the purpose for which a committee has been constituted. So this purpose must be articulated and defined clearly. Next requirement is to define the composition of the committee. This everyone does. I mean, there is no problem with this aspect of the functioning of committees. So typically, everyone will have the screen should be visible. There is still a complaint of screen not visible. But from my side, it is showing as shared. So I don't know if there is an issue. From my screen and from my computer, it is showing that the screen is visible to everyone. So in the composition, we have to have a chairperson of the committee. We need a quorum. Quorum is something not with which many people may not be familiar. Quorum is the minimum number of people of the total composition of the committee who are required for committee to be legally or to be formally capable of taking a decision. So for example, you may have an infection control committee which will have, let us say, the medical director of the hospital as the chairperson. You have all the clinical heads as the member. You have a microbiologist as the technical member or the technical expert in the committee. And then you have other people like somebody who's heading the maybe the OT or operation theater, or somebody who's heading the infectious disease program in the hospital. So those people are also part of the committee. Now, typically, an infection control committee will have a large membership. So you have in a large hospital of, let's say, 300-bedded multi-specialty or a super-specialty hospital, you may have an infection control committee which will have maybe 15, 20 members. Now, in such a large member committee, if you, it is not possible or it may happen that not everybody is able to attend all the meetings. So you have to define a quorum, which means a minimum membership that should be there and minimum people who should be there for this committee to be effective and this committee to be able to take a decision. So usually we have a chairperson and we also define a co-chair. So if a chairperson is not able to attend, then the co-chair is the person who attends the meeting and he chairs the meeting. So at least there is a chairperson for the committee. Then we need to define a secretary or a convener of the committee, a person who is responsible for taking out all the notifications, the committee meeting notices, and recording the minutes of the meeting. This can also be done by a dedicated staff in the administrative wing of the hospital, or it can be done by the secretary. Sometimes they may require clerical help in the sense that a person to record the proceedings may be required. But in a lot of hospitals, I have seen the secretaries themselves record while the committee is meeting and discussing the agenda for the each of this meeting. So minimum requirement is to have a chairperson, a co-chair, that means a number two in the committee who heads the or who chairs the meetings when the chairperson is not there. And then you define a quorum and the secretary. Then we have to define the task or the charter of duties. A committee which is a cross-function committee, infection control or the credentialing or any of these committees, you'll have to define a typical charter of duties as to what all they will do. So they will address the infection control activities, they will address the surveillance, they will define the surveillance periodicity. You may have a system where they will also supervise the CSSD validation. So like that, you can decide what will be the charter of duties. In the Research Foundation, when we organize this program for the hospital quality systems, we have made a sample charter for various committees. So all those who want to kind of access this will have to write to us. We will be able to share that charter that we have made. It is an indicative list of things that the hospitals can use for designing the charter for their committees. So it works and you can add as per your requirement. So if you want to add something to this list, you can. In order to receive this, we will need to have the email ID. So if you want, this can be shared. The next requirement is the minuting of meetings. Now, minuting means basically recording the decisions. So if a committee is meeting and they are discussing certain agenda points, certain issues, for example, in a quarter, if there were excessively large or unusually large number of ventilator-associated pneumonias in one of the ICUs in the hospital, then the infection control committee should be discussing this aspect. And when the discussion happens, these have to be recorded. And this recorded minutes work as the reference point for all future meetings also, and for taking the corrective actions, which invariably will be taken after the committee takes a decision. And then finally, we need to have an evaluation criteria for each of these committees as to what will be the criteria based on which they will be evaluated. There can be some generic criteria. For example, you can have that whether the committee is meeting as it is designed to meet. So if it is quarterly, then are they meeting every quarter? Who are the members who are regularly meeting, and who are the members who are not meeting or not attending the meetings? Then you can have a criteria, for example, whether you have members who are not contributing, so you may think of replacing those members with people who might be interested in contributing to the committees. So basically, the intent is that we have a committee system which effectively helps us in improving the systems in the hospital. Even after all, the very purpose of having a committee is to have an improvement in the hospital systems. And we are looking at the committees from the perspective of a quality system design. So if the committees are not able to result in improvement, then what is the point in having a committee? So that's the objective that needs to be kept in mind when we decide the evaluation criteria. And last point is having a method of evaluation. So this is a requirement in the NABH standards, and it is also a requirement in the JCI standards that hospitals must evaluate the effectiveness of their committees that they have in their hospital. So we have a tool which is called the SAEO Committee Evaluation Model. And this model can be used. It can be provided to people who are interested in taking this. It gives a template on which the evaluation can be done, and there are instructions as to how this committee evaluation model can be deployed in the hospital. It enables evaluation of the committees. It enables the recording of evaluation, and over a period of time, you can actually figure out which committees are able to function properly, which ones are not able to function properly. And if the committees are, if you have members who are not contributing, they just are attending and not contributing, or you may have some members who are just not interested, so they may not be attending at all. So this evaluation model addresses that, and the hospital management, the governing entity as it is called, the top management, can take the decisions regarding reconstituting or amending the constitution of a particular committee. So this is the tool that we have, and in this it's a two-stage model. So you evaluate the structure of the committee once, because the structure is defined only once, and only and it is re-evaluated when you modify the structure. Structure means the membership of the committee and the chairperson and other people who are part of the committee. And the stage two is every time a meeting committee meets, this evaluation has to be, stage two evaluation has to be carried out. The scoring system is there. So based on that score, you can actually have a tracking whether the scores are improving or not improving. So it gives you an objective method of knowing whether a committee is able to contribute. So this is a copyrighted tool, it's a intellectual property of the institute. So it must be shared in exact form like this. The modifications may not be done for this tool. So I have finished the today's agenda, that is the committee structures. And this this is a topic which is important for all of us to know. This is a topic which affects all of us, because at our level of functioning, all of us are in some committee or the other. So when we are part of a committee, we should know how this committee is being evaluated and how it is contributing to the work.